next on Unsolved Mysteries. 13 women were murdered by a brutal serial killer called the Boston Strangler. Most people believe Albert DeSalvo was guilty of these crimes, but new evidence suggests that may not be the case. Strange lights have been spotted and photographed in the night sky. Are they a new generation of top-secret aircraft? A teenage girl vanishes without a trace. Could this be her, captured on tape in this gas station video? And after 50 years of separation, a brother and a sister have been reunited, thanks to you.
Five cases with strange clues, bizarre twists, and with secrets you would never expect. I'm Dennis Farina, and this is Unsolved Mysteries.
In the early 1960s, Boston was gripped with fear. A killer was on the loose. 10 women were found murdered. They ranged in age from 19 to 75, and they had different ethnic backgrounds. They lived in different neighborhoods.
The only thing these women had in common was that they were both strangled to death in their own apartments. The police were frustrated. The public was terrified. They named the killer the Boston Strangler.
There are stories of women rushing out to dog pounds to buy every available stray mutt for protection. Locksmiths reported a run on their businesses. People were obviously quite clearly frightened by whatever was out there.
10 months after the last murder, few people noticed when a man named Albert DeSalvo was arrested on unrelated sexual assault charges. DeSalvo was married and had 2 children. He also had an extensive history of sexual offenses. One of his many nicknames was the Measuring Man.
Come on in. Wow, your neighbors were right. You really are beautiful. My name is Jack Johnson. I'm from the Cambridge modeling agency over in Cambridge.
DeSalvo pretended to be recruiting fashion models. Right, he would smooth talk his way into women's homes, measure them for clothing, and then fondle them.
Here's a contract I was talking to you about.
DeSalvo's scam eventually caught up with him. He was arrested and sent to prison for 1 year. After DeSalvo's release, police began receiving complaints about the Green Man, a maintenance worker who talked his way into women's apartments and then assaulted them.
Good morning. Yes. How are you?
Fine. How are you?
Good. The superintendent told me to take a look at your plumbing.
She would let him in. He would make an overture to her. If the overture were repelled, he would leave. But a surprising number of times, it wasn't, according to him. And he ended up making love with the woman. Later, his assaults became much more aggressive. Eventually, these were the charges that he was arrested for.
Oh, come in, Mr. DeSalvo.
DeSalvo was arrested and sent to a mental hospital. Dr. Ames Roby was the medical director there.
I see here that you've been charged with a series of molestations.
Molestation may be too strong a word.
Well, how do you mean?
Well, I mean, all the women I was with, they had a very good time.
Well, the first thing that was so obvious about Albert was his incredible need to be somebody important.
How many women would you say you introduced yourself to with your measuring and repair work schemes?
600.
600?
He would brag about almost anything. He gave the feeling, although he didn't say so at that time, that he sort of wanted to be as well known as, in quotes, the Boston Strangler.
3 months later, George Nassar, another inmate at Bridgewater, had an odd conversation about the Boston Strangler with his lawyer, F. Lee Bailey.
If a man was a strangler, the guy who killed all those women, would it be possible for him to publish his story and make some money with it?
He asked me whether or not it would be possible for someone who had done the stranglings to write a book. And my offhand answer was sure, but you might go to the electric chair as a consequence. Later on, I was asked to go down and see this fellow, Albert DeSalvo, by my client.
Albert, specifically, what do you want me to do for you?
I got a wife. I got a two-year-old son, a seven-year-old daughter, and I know I'm going to be locked up for the rest of my life. I just hope it's in a house.
I was a little incredulous because everybody develops a profile. You're looking for a monster, somebody, you know, whose jowls are dripping, and just didn't seem to fit.
There are obvious problems about confessing to a crime in print when there hasn't been a trial.
He wanted to be able to tell his story. He said, I would like to find out why I am like this. Maybe people could give me tests or something.
Before we even consider that, I need to know what that story is.
Well, as George probably told you, I'm the one they're looking for. The one that did all the stranglings.
Okay.
I had no way of knowing whether or not he was telling the truth, fantasizing because he was crazy, or had read a lot of things in the newspapers and wanted to be famous.
Let's move on to Sophie Clark.
2 days later, Bailey returned to Bridgewater with a tape recorder and a list of questions. With DeSalvo's permission, Bailey had struck a deal with the Boston police. They would provide Bailey with details only the Strangler would know as a way of testing DeSalvo. In return, Bailey was guaranteed the tapes would never be heard in court.
It's, you know, like a stocking or something to wrap around the neck. And I knocked a pack of cigarettes on the floor. I left him there when I left.
Oh, this guy has got to be it.
His description of the crime scenes, it was just so accurate that that impressed me very much.
We have to proceed cautiously. But when Dr. Ames Roby heard the tape, he was not impressed. He believed there was another explanation for DeSalvo's knowledge of the crime scenes.
Albert indicated to us that he had gone to the various sites that the newspapers had named after the police tapes and the like were off the doors in the apartments, just to sort of be there and see what it was like.
Fascinated, you know. I just wanted to be there, walk around, get a feeling for it.
Dr. Roby says that DeSalvo had a photographic memory. He may have visited the victim's apartments, or perhaps he was just repeating what someone else had described to him. Roby began to believe that DeSalvo's friend, George Nassar, was somehow involved.
I first began to wonder about something going on when no other inmates would come near them. And they would immediately stop talking if the guards or staff came anywhere near where they could hear. But they would have extensive conversations about what, of course, we didn't know.
A career criminal, George Nassar had been in prison for killing a gas station attendant shortly after the Strangler killed his last victim. At our request, Nassar agreed to discuss his role in the case and his relationship with Albert DeSalvo for the first time.
With Albert DeSalvo, I was simply an associate. I've done the same thing with many, many prisoners. People come to me and ask me for advice. I give it to them. If they say, if it's worthy of me assisting them, I assist them, for my reasons, because I feel it's a worthy thing to do.
The Massachusetts Attorney General ordered that news of DeSalvo's confession be kept under wraps. Within the police department, there was a split over whether DeSalvo was, in fact, the killer.
I really couldn't break it down percentage-wise. Probably a little more than 50% believed DeSalvo was the strangler, and a little less than 50% believed he was not the strangler.
Then someone leaked the story of the confession to the local newspapers.
I don't want you to be frightened.
In response to the story, two women came forward. One was a survivor of a possible strangler attack. The other was a neighbor of one of the victims. They were brought to Bridgewater to see if they recognized any of the inmates.
Did you see somebody? Which one?
The gentleman all the way in the back, right next to the guard.
Next to the guard?
Yes, next to the guard.
Surprisingly, the one familiar face did not belong to Albert DeSalvo, but to George Nassar. Next, George Nassar responds to the charge that he is the Boston Strangler. By the spring of 1965, investigators were totally convinced that Albert DeSalvo was the Boston Strangler. And then they were stunned when a witness was brought to a state mental hospital and identified a different inmate as the strangler. That man is a convicted killer named George Nassar.
George Nassar would fit the profile of the Boston Strangler. We found nothing that would rule him out, not even one iota.
I do not kill women. I've never conceived of it. I wouldn't conceive of it. I have a great respect and regard for women, beginning with my mother, who brought me up that way.
George Nassar was eliminated as the strangler. I don't think he had the profile of a strangler. George Nassar used a gun.
All right, Albert. I want you to imagine a calendar.
Albert DeSalvo was the state's prime suspect, even though there was no physical evidence that linked him to any of the killings. DeSalvo's attorney, F. Lee Bailey, suggested that DeSalvo undergo hypnosis.
We had him hypnotized and age regressed right through one of the homicides, and the things that developed in the presence of a very bright medical hypnotist were of great interest.
I didn't want to hurt. I had to hurt her to help her.
This recreation is based upon F. Lee Bailey's account of the hypnosis session.
When you were strangling that woman, who were you really trying to hurt? Albert?
My mother.
Yeah. The session seemed to reveal that DeSalvo had had problems with every significant woman in his life.
We found an involvement of his wife, who he married in Germany, his daughter, who had a physical disability that troubled him greatly, his mother, for whom he had a love-hate relationship, and it was just the beginning.
I love her.
No, Albert. No, you don't.
The
answers were almost implied, Albert, in the question, which, at least from my training, is something you don't do.
Albert,
I love her.
Tell me how you really feel about her.
I love her,
Albert.
I love her.
Dr. Ames Roby observed the session and came to a completely different conclusion.
I was not at all convinced that anything had been uncovered, and was a little surprised later when Mr. Bailey announced that what had occurred under hypnosis was definitive evidence. Albert, even with the crimes he was charged with, he was considered gentle, polite. His sexual proclivities, his general attitude, he was not angry and hostile.
Once you were inside the apartment, what did you see?
The Massachusetts Attorney General's office conducted its own interrogations. The transcripts of those interviews were never released, but author Susan Kelly obtained a copy while researching her book called Deadly Charade.
When you read the transcript of those interrogations, and you come to a point where Albert gives an incorrect answer to a question, he is guided to give the correct answer. And Albert, who was a smart guy, caught on very quickly.
I remember I took the chairs out and I remember laying them down on their back.
Where did you get the chairs? From the dining room?
Yeah, from the dining room.
This man was not the Boston Strangler. He didn't kill anyone.
They had the right guy beyond question. No one has ever come up with anything meaningful to contradict that. The question was, how could we try him as the Strangler and close the file in the public mind?
F. Lee Bailey struck a deal with the state. Albert DeSalvo went on trial, but not as the Boston Strangler. Instead, he was tried for sexual assault and other crimes in connection with the Green Man case. In return, the state agreed not to press for the death penalty.
This session.
That's all we wanted. Nobody ever wanted Albert on the street, including Albert, until asked not to be executed so that he could be studied, seemed to me a reasonable objective.
After less than 4 hours of deliberation, the jury reached its verdict.
On all counts of breaking and entering, and on all counts of unnatural acts, the jury finds the defendant guilty.
DeSalvo had wanted to be sent to a mental hospital, but his insanity defense failed. DeSalvo was found guilty on 8 criminal counts. He was sentenced to life in prison.
To be imprisoned for the balance of his natural life.
It was a much more severe sentence than he would have received normally on the sex charges of which he'd been convicted. But he was being sent to prison as the Boston Strangler. It was that simple.
I think the most difficult part of all of this was that whether they had it solved or not, they had quieted the public's concern. So theoretically, everyone was happy.
In prison, DeSalvo was reunited with his old friend George Nassar. Once again, questions were raised regarding Nassar's possible involvement with the stranglings.
Because Al wasn't tried, this case had become mythical. It became part of like a public fantasy of what really happened. It became a continuing mystery when it should have been resolved. And I was part of the mystery.
Outside of prison, Albert had become a legend. But inside, he feared his fame had made him a marked man. After more than 6 years behind bars, DeSalvo asked to be transferred to a cell in the prison infirmary. Here, he would be isolated from the other inmates. On the evening of November 25th, 1973, DeSalvo telephoned his former psychiatrist, Dr. Ames Roby.
Hello?
Dr. Roby?
Yes?
Albert DeSalvo.
He wanted to talk to me, to tell me the, quote, real story.
It'd be a good idea for you to come down here tomorrow. There's some things I need to talk to you about.
Well, can't we just talk here on the phone?
No. Listen, I got a reporter coming down here at 2 o'clock tomorrow. I think it'd be a good idea for you to come as well.
He didn't say what the real story was, and I could only hope that this is what I would hear, but I never heard it.
When everybody assembled, it was in this infirmary in my office as soon as possible.
Before DeSalvo could talk to Dr. Roby and the reporter, he was found in his cell, murdered, stabbed repeatedly in the chest. Some believe that DeSalvo was involved in a drug deal gone bad. Others, including George Nassar, say DeSalvo was killed in a dispute over cuts of meat that he was allegedly selling on the prison black market.
Somebody didn't want that interview happening. And I think they have said before, dead men tell no tales.
3 inmates were eventually charged with Albert DeSalvo's murder, but no one was ever convicted. Was Albert DeSalvo the Boston Strangler?
Albert DeSalvo was the Boston Strangler. We learned that at great and tragic expense to the community and then wasted him away. We could have learned a lot from Albert. We didn't.
I think Albert became the Boston Strangler because he wanted so much to be the Boston Strangler. It was the most important thing in his life. For somebody who felt all his life that he was a nobody, all of a sudden he could become world-renowned.
Shortly after his murder, authorities came across a collection of poems that DeSalvo had written while in prison. One of them provided an intriguing footnote to the legend of the Boston Strangler.
Here's the story of the Strangler, yet untold. The man who claims he murdered 13 women, young and old. Today he sits in a prison cell, Deep inside, only a secret he can tell. People everywhere are still in doubt. Is the Strangler in prison or roaming about?
Next, this gas station video shows a young girl who looks just like a missing teenager named Wendy Von Huben. Could it be her? The girl in this surveillance footage from a gas station is thought to be a missing 16-year-old girl named Wendy Von Huben. It is a crucial clue in the baffling case of Wendy and her boyfriend, Jesse Howell. Wendy Von Huben and Jesse Howell longed for life beyond their small town. They left Illinois and ran away together. It would turn out that this was a very bad and a very dangerous decision. Wendy and her family had recently moved to a small farming town in Illinois called Woodstock. Wendy did not adjust well to the move. She had trouble in her new school, and she was restless.
She wanted to be old, but she didn't want to grow up. She wanted to play. She was 16, going on 42, and at times only 8.
Wendy fell in love with 19-year-old Jesse Howell. Jesse was already on his own.
He wanted to be who he wanted to be, but he couldn't quite figure out who that was. He left the house and struck out on his own. He thought he could make it all by himself and take care of himself.
Yeah, bye, Mom.
Just days after Wendy turned 16, she told her parents that she was spending the night with her friend. But Wendy had other plans.
Hey, baby.
The following day, when she didn't show up on the time when she was supposed to, we waited several hours. We had no calls. The phone number that she gave us let us know where it wasn't to anyone that we knew or she knew. So we knew there was a problem. We called and filed a missing persons report.
Man, I'm so glad to be out of this.
Wendy and Jesse left Illinois with two other teenagers. But just a few days after arriving in Florida, the young couple's romantic plans for a new life fell apart.
They started getting on each other's nerves. They pulled into a truck stop. And Jesse and Wendy got out of the car, and this other teenager and his girlfriend figured, well, this is the perfect time to get rid of them. They got back in the car, and that was the last that they saw of Jesse and Wendy at that time.
Wendy and Jesse were nearly 1,500 miles from home with hardly any money and no transportation. But they were able to disappear, and the police lost their trail. A month later, Wendy's father was at work when he received a phone call from a homeless shelter in Bradenton.
Hello.
Is this William Von Huben?
Yes. Who's this?
This is John O'Brien.
And I'm a worker at the Tobler shelter here.
He said he worked with a group that dealt with runaway kids. And it turned out that he had Wendy and Jesse there with him.
Hold on. Wendy, it's your dad. Come on, talk to him.
Daddy?
She was crying, said she wanted to come home.
Wendy.
She didn't like living on the street. I sent her down $200 at his bus fare to come home. I was relieved, to say the least. I mean, at least I knew that it was in the process of her returning.
Jesse, Mom.
A few days later, Jesse called his parents from a truck stop. He also said that he and Wendy were on their way home.
I know.
And when I continued to press him to give me more information, he suddenly said, I've got to go or I'll miss my ride. Don't worry, be happy. I love you. I'm fine. And was gone. And that's the last we heard from him.
Wendy and Jesse picked up the money that her parents wired to them, but they never made it home. 48 hours later, 80 miles north of Dade City, Florida, a train engineer spotted a body in the bushes near the railroad tracks. 19-year-old Jesse Howell was dead.
All of our plans for him, for our family, for our future were suddenly changed. And there was nothing we could say or do or fix to make it turn around and go back the way it was going to be. It was just done.
Jesse had been killed by blunt trauma to the head. There was still money in his pocket and a half-smoked cigarette on the ground.
He was struck from behind, had no idea of what was happening. There was no struggle at the scene. That, paired with the fact that there was a clear path showing that his body was dragged through the tall grass, clearly indicates to me that this is a homicide. The crime lab was able to locate a drop of blood on the cuff of his jacket that was not Jesse's. There are indicators that this could be Wendy's blood.
Land and air searches for Wendy turned up nothing. She had disappeared without a trace.
Everything's left to your imagination at this point. You have no idea what's going on, completely out of control.
They were always together, so she had to be there. She was there, she was close by, she knew what happened.
More than 2 months passed. Then, the phone rang at the home of Wendy's parents.
Hello?
And they said it was a collect call. Will you accept the charges? And then they asked her to identify herself.
Mom? It's me. It's me.
In a crying voice, she said, "It's me, Wendy." And then she hung up.
Laura went next door to call the police. At 8 o'clock, the Van Eubens' phone rang again.
Hello?
Hi, Dad.
Wendy? Is that you?
The girl said she was calling from Kankakee, Illinois, the town where Wendy and her family had lived until 18 months earlier.
I said, "Where in Kankakee?" She said she didn't know. I said, "Well, where are you calling from?" She said, "Phillips 66 station." I said, "Is there a number on the phone?" She said, "No, there's no number." Everything was yes or no or single word answers.
Listen, I gotta go. Bye.
The conversation was so short, William could not be sure if the girl on the phone was actually Wendy.
You hope against hope, but then again, you want proof. Is this it? And I couldn't, you know, identify her voice.
I went down to Kankakee, and based on the caller to the Van Eubens saying that there wasn't a phone number on a payphone, I checked all the payphones at the Phillips 66 stations. One payphone on Indiana Street did not have the phone number posted in the normal space. I assumed then that maybe this was the phone that the call was made from and obtained a surveillance tape from that gas station.
This is that surveillance tape. It shows a teenage girl matching Wendy's description. Police estimate the video was recorded within minutes of the call to the Van Eubens.
When I saw the video, I cried and I said, "That's it. That's her. She's put on weight, but that's her. That's her body language. She does her hair that way. She puts her hands in her pockets like that. That's her attitude. That's the way she walks." I was positive that that was my kid.
But then another complication. Police subpoena phone records, and when they later traced the call, they discovered it was made from a different gas station just 2 miles away. At that station, there was a flyer posted with the Van Eubens' home phone number.
Hopefully, it was Wendy that made the phone call, but if it wasn't, it was somebody that saw the phone number on that flyer and possibly was making a very, very cruel joke to him.
I'll go anywhere it takes to get her. Hell and back. I don't care where she's at. I'll go there, and I'll get her, and I'll bring her home. All she has to do is just say, "I'm here, and come get me. I don't care where she is. I'll come."
Update. Sadly, a man known as the Railroad Killer has confessed to murdering Wendy Van Eubens and Jesse Howell. The killer, Angel Resendiz, claims they decided to catch a ride with him on a freight train and then look for work picking oranges. When the train stopped at a switching station, Jesse got off, and that's when Resendiz hit him in the head and killed him. 8 hours later, Resendiz ordered Wendy off the train. He strangled her, wrapped her in a blanket, and covered the body with leaves. When he confessed, Resendiz was already on death row in Texas for killing a Houston doctor. He received immunity in exchange for leading police to Wendy's body. Authorities believe Resendiz was responsible for at least 15 murders. He was executed in Texas in June of 2006. Next, strange lights are seen in the night sky. Could they be UFOs or a secret aircraft developed by our military? This video was shot by a camera crew hired by Aviation Week magazine. Eyewitnesses say it shows a pencil-thin aircraft trailing balls of golden light. In this footage, a conventional airplane, seen here, is being filmed when a mysterious object suddenly appears. The object travels at a high rate of speed and exhibits pinpoint maneuverability. In this haunting image, several eyewitnesses observe an unusual light source, possibly an aircraft hovering over the Nevada desert. And here, an unknown wedge-shaped object, which makes no noise, flies over Roswell, New Mexico. The footage was shot by a man named Stephen Douglas of Amarillo, Texas.
People have been sighting and witnessing aircraft that can do fantastic, amazing things. I mean, high speed, stop on a dime, turn like a ballet dancer.
Douglas believes that the mysterious lights are, in fact, experimental military jets. He thinks they're being kept under wraps, just as the legendary stealth fighter was for nearly a decade. Recently, there has been speculation about a new spy plane, said to travel at speeds exceeding Mach 6. Douglas obtained what he believes is evidence that the plane may actually exist.
It was probably about 11 a.m. and the house began to rattle. Let me call you back. This house just really shook. So I went outside and there was this aircraft flying by over the house, incredibly fast. I've seen a lot of aircraft crisscross the skies around here, but this thing, I couldn't believe how fast it was moving. And behind it, it left a contrail that was unique, what they call a donuts on a rope contrail.
Stephen Douglas took this photograph of the contrail. Some aviation researchers believe that it might have been made by experimental technology allegedly used in the spy plane. The Air Force said they could not identify the source of the contrail in the photograph. Douglas had another unusual sighting a year later. He was videotaping military airplanes that were participating in mock war games. Shortly after a group of B-1 bombers took off, an unidentified aircraft entered the area. But Douglas only had 10 seconds left on his camera battery.
My battery just quit.
This aircraft made no sound at all. It was just super quiet. It looked like a flying triangle. And immediately I knew it must have been TR-3A Black Manta.
The Black Manta is another of the top secret aircraft supposedly developed by the military. It is thought to be a reconnaissance plane that operates in tandem with the stealth fighter. But in a statement issued to Unsolved Mysteries, the Air Force said of the Manta, quote, "It has no basis in reality." When the Air Force analyzed Douglas's footage, they believe the aircraft might be a Navy EA-6B Prowler. However, the Navy could not identify the plane, citing the poor quality of the videotape. A computer enhancement appears to show a triangular-shaped wedge. Douglas claims the object was virtually silent and moved slower than any conventional military aircraft.
These aircraft are doing things which a lot of physicists have generally said are not possible. You know, their maneuvers, their the way they fly, how fast they are. And the real mystery is how they made the leap. There are some that speculate that maybe this technology was gleaned from alien technology that somehow either we have recovered or has been here for a while.
The Pentagon has never confirmed the existence or recovery of alien spacecraft. However, since this story aired, the Air Force has publicly admitted that there is a plane called the Manta. First the stealth, now the Manta. What other top secret aircraft might invade our skies? Next, the story of a man's 50-year search for his sister and their touching reunion. Ottumwa, Iowa, 1941. Three brothers and a sister have been left in the care of their aunt. She fears for the children's well-being and has contacted the Child Welfare Department.
Walter, Donald, Richard, Dolores, I need to take you to your new home now. Walter, you're a big boy. Now you're going out to that car. Hurry up.
I was just probably about 5.5 years old. I didn't know anything about adoption. I thought we was just going to this home, and later on we was going to go back to Mama's thing.
Now you just hush up and sit still.
Donald Stratt's mother could do nothing to prevent the state from taking her children. She was pregnant with her fifth child and unable to work. A few months earlier, Donald's father had been institutionalized after a nervous breakdown. Two of the brothers were sent to Iowa State youth facilities. Donald and his sister Dolores were taken to a Lutheran children's home.
A little rest. Dolores, here's your bottle.
Mm-hmm. Let me try.
Even though I wasn't the oldest boy, I was the babysitter. And I played with my sister. I always like to help her because she's my sister.
But within days, Donald knew that he and his sister would not be going back to their mother. He started looking for a way to escape. And then one day, when the nurse was busy, they got their chance.
This was our chance to go home. And I sneaked her out the door and down the steps and out to this old Model A Ford. And I told her, now you sit right there because we're going home to see Mama. I didn't know anything about cars really, but I knew if you pushed that button down on the floor, that car would go. I was trying to get this car down there on that main road. I didn't know which way I was going when I got there, but I knew that road, I came in on it, and I needed to leave by it, you know.
What do you think you're doing? You get out of that car right now. Don't you know you could kill somebody?
She reached in and grabbed me up by the collar and went thrashing on me, you know. And I knew she was whipping me, but I didn't feel no pain, and I was fighting her because I was wanting to go home.
Donald, there's some cookies for you in the kitchen if you'd like them.
2 weeks later, Dolores was adopted.
Come on, baby. We're gonna get you a new home.
These people come and took Dolores away. I didn't know what the deal was, but I thought, well, they're gonna bring her back here because me and her was family, and that's all I had.
The separation didn't last long. Dolores's adoptive parents sent for Donald when they realized that she was more than they can handle.
Dolores wouldn't adjust to these folks or bond with these folks at first, and just cried and wanted her brother because, you know, we'd been together. And these people were strangers to her. She just cried and wouldn't eat or whatever, and that's the reason they came and got me. So I could be a quieting factor, you might say.
With Donald there, Dolores began to adjust. Donald's help was no longer needed.
Donnie, you want to go downtown with me?
I remember looking up, and this woman was feeding my little sister, and I thought, well, everything's all right, you know. Yeah, I'd like to go downtown, you know. Of course, I didn't realize this automobile was never going to bring me back. And we got in the car and we drove off, and I haven't seen my sister since. I think of Dolores, you know, almost every day. She's still my sister, no matter, you know, what time has done. But I'd like to hug her neck and tell her, mister.
Update. The night we aired this story, a woman named Penelope Sue Lewis of Ball Iver, Missouri, was watching. She identified herself as Donald's long-lost sister, Dolores. She lived only 50 miles away. 3 days later, Donald, Penelope, and their families gathered for a long overdue reunion.
Oh, God, it's been so many years.
I love her. I always have loved her. And sometimes when I get alone, get to think about it, I just sit down and cry. And I don't mind crying this time because I'm already there.
But I got another surprise for you.
Yeah.
Soon after seeing Donald, Penelope's natural mother, Velma, arrived. They had not seen each other in over 50 years.
Oh. Mm. Oh. I never thought I'd see this day.
For Penelope, the gathering was also the chance to meet all the family members she never knew she had.
I felt so helpless. I felt like I didn't belong. And now I'm at peace.